Maybe I'm telling myself that, but there ain't nothing that'll change that. What good would it be if I knew how you felt about me? Yeah. It could've been right, but I was wrong. Only think about you and I'm alone. Part of me that cared is just gone, and I know that I can't get caught up. We could've been, and we try to pretend. Every now and again, we don't dream about, don't think about what we could've been. No, I'm holding it in, 'cause I know in the end, you dream about, I think about what we could've been. We could've been, we could've, damn, remember, remember the night in Miami, first time you put your arms around me, I'm up reminiscing, and thinking about you isn't helping, thinking about you doesn't tell me, what good it would do, if I decide to face the truth, it could've been right, but I was wrong. Only think about you when I'm alone. You only hit me up when she's not home, and that's why I can't get caught up. We could've been, and we try to pretend. Every now and again, we don't dream about, don't think about what we could've been. Oh, yeah. I'm holding it in, 'cause I know in the end, you dream about, I think about what we could've been, we could've been, we could've, we could've been, we could've been, we could've been.
Benvenuti, buongiorno, buongiorno a tutti.
Good
Welcome
morning, everyone.
We have about 680 people following from everywhere in the world. Però il benvenuto veramente più caloroso lo vorrei dare a chi è venuto fino qui.
Welcome is addressed to those who are here physically. We are numerous and we are in a marvelous place. Welcome by all of us at Fedrigoni. We are at the Compassador Museum, which has just been inaugurated. It is a place that you can visit later. There is also an exhibition that we contributed to, and it is a real party. I would really like to say we made it. We made it because this is a real celebration of people and projects, and we're all here in person. You are going to meet them later on, but today is the day where we reap the fruits of a work, and also the work of brands, graphic artists, printers, label producers, the box producers, the whole chain that is gathered here. It is a fantastic opportunity to see the objects, speak with people. We are social animals, and creativity comes from interaction with people and things. So I would also like to thank those who tried to come here and could not because of COVID rules. This is the first day in Italy when it is possible to organize big events. This is the biggest event that we could organize. So the 1st of July was the first day where these kind of events are allowed. So many projects have been presented. 1,100 projects have been submitted with incredible figures and a very high quality. I would like to thank all of you and especially the jury that managed to really work properly. So 400 projects were shortlisted and they were sent physically to our headquarters in November. They were all analyzed by a jury that I'm about to introduce to you. There might be images of the jury that really met in November in Verona and assessed and examined all projects. So 1,100 projects, 600 designers, printers and converters, and box producers, 32 countries, 400 shortlisted projects, 50 finalists, and later we are going to reveal the winners. I would like to introduce to you the jury. Slides of the jury are going to appear soon. In the jury we have Silvana Matto, that is here with us tonight, this evening, this afternoon. Simon Esterson from London. Roger Botti from Robiland, Tocqua Mantilla from Kiko, Martina Corradi, marketing manager at HP Indigo. Martina, where are you? Here you are. Frank Gerard, the production director and editor at Taschen. And then we have some greetings, some welcome remarks from Min Wang and Ivan Bell that are going to greet us via video.
To be the jury member of the Top Award. And it was very nice to see so many good design from different parts of the globe. From Shanghai, I wish good luck to all the participants and congratulate to the winners. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Ivan Bell. It's been an honour this year to be a jury member at this year's Fedrigoni Top Awards. And despite the global pandemics, all the lockdowns and travel restrictions, it has been inspiring to see so many innovative and well-designed submissions. Those of you that have won this year should be very proud. The competition was toughly fought. Congratulations to all the winners. Salute and chin chin.
Grazie.
Thank you.
Siamo felici.
We are happy that you have the opportunity to interact with each other and to interact with the jury later and really gather ideas and inspiration for new projects. For me, speaking with Marco Nespolo is a great source of inspiration. He's the CEO of Fedrigoni Group. Marco, come here.
And another very, very warm welcome, building on what Chiara just said. So glad we could make it. Actually, as I shared with, I think, many of you in the past, my very early days at Fedrigoni back 2.5 years ago were in Verona with the jury, learning about this new business and the so many applications that we are helping all of you making. Then in Berlin was really just a few months after I joined, and that was really a fantastic experience. So there is, of course, a piece of art, in a sense, on my end into this platform. But there actually, beyond that, there are at least two great reasons on how we felt so strongly that we wanted to be so quickly, and why we are extremely happy of having you both here, for those of you in Milan and everyone around the globe. Number one is that for a company like us, whose purpose and mission are summarized into elevating creativity, there's no better place, there's no better platform than diving into this ecosystem of brand owner, designer, printers, converter, and there's so many partners down this ecosystem to really touch the products, look at the creation, see and understand more and more what we can do to help, sharing thoughts, ideas, and with so many applications and so many creations that we can really dive into, as Chiara already said. So this is really, really precious, a source of inspiration for all of us, and learning on how to make Fedrigoni a better and better partner for all of you. And we believe it so strongly that we also want to make it a yearly effort as opposed to do it every other year. So we are really here to invite you in advance for the November 22 edition in Paris of the Fedrigoni Top Award. So again, we'll move on a yearly pace as opposed to every other year, as a testament to how much we do believe in this platform and how much we do enjoy the interaction with all of you also in this context on top of our day-to-day partnership. Then the second reason on how we felt so strong about having that so soon is that it's really a sort of symbol, as Chiara alluded to, of a new beginning. After, I think, 18 months or so of the craziest experience in our life, both personally and professionally, after having gone through months where many of the applications that you normally create have been severely impacted by the global pandemic, and after many months where the human touch, the physical aspects of our products and your creations were impossible. Again, as soon as the world is, fingers crossed, reopening, we wanted to do that and celebrate. And we are celebrating the ability to do that in person, for those of you that are here, and starting to do more and more so. But also, fortunately, and as importantly, honestly, I think for all of our businesses, we are also here celebrating, fortunately, a great market that is reopening. Based on the pretty privileged point of view that we have in dealing with so many of you around the globe, I think there's no applications out of those that, again, we are busy with collectively, that is not super sparkly now, not just in terms of demand, which of course is a decent starting point, but also in terms of intensity of projects that you're all working on and we are all trying to help with. So as soon as the war is restarting and the market is back, again, we are super happy of having this opportunity to stay, spend time with all of you. So I really look forward to, for those of you here, to interacting more later in the day. Then to close like this kind of very short welcome, I just want to re-emphasize on our end something which is very important, growingly important also for Fedrigoni, and that not by chance will be largely dealt with during the next sessions today, which is about ESG and sustainability. I am risking to state in the obvious, of course, sustainability is not only something great for all of us that should be engaging for us, for the planet in general, but it's also more and more a condition precedent to stay in business in the long term. All of you are extremely busy with coping with this extraordinary acceleration on how relevant this is, and of course we want to do our part into it. Over the last 12 months, of course, after dealing, having dealt with that for a long time, but after, over the last 12 months, we really did accelerate extensively on our efforts in shaping a very detailed plan to bring Fedrigoni to the next level in terms of ESG and sustainability. We just went live with a very specific set of initiatives and metrics that we publicly commit to and will periodically monitor progress against. You have read something in terms of how we are dialing up on that. I hope, even more importantly, you are perceiving our efforts in the products we are developing and the type of interaction we are having with you. But more importantly, the pledge we want to make today in the first opportunity we have to spend some time together is to do that, not, let's say, the easier way. I think you all live, contacts with so many players, not just in this industry, but everywhere, that have more of a greenwashing as opposed to true commitment, have more like taking something very small in the bigger scheme of things and emphasizing that to move away from the real topics. So that's not what we want to do. We really commit, and again, please hold us on this, to be very open and honest on what are the complexity and the trade-off that especially in this ecosystem are clearly there, in helping you, in listening to you in terms of what you need, whether you're a brand owner, a printer, a converter, or a designer, to really understand how to crack the case, how they say it in English, and really improve accepting trade-offs and going around those as opposed to just have high-level, wishy-washy claims that really nobody maybe can either understand or are really not to the point. So this open and honest, fact-based and transparent approach is what we pledged to. And again, once again, please hold on this. I hope you really perceive that in coming months. Having said that, enjoy the rest of the sessions and the setting where we are for those here. Thanks for joining. Thanks for the continued partnership and dialogue, even over the last incredible months. And look forward again to partially shake hands today with you and share thoughts later on in the evening. Enjoy. Thanks.
Grazie Marco. Abbiamo visto.
In recent months, we've been exposed to two phenomena that were quite unique. One has been a deluge of mono-use plastic and then a deluge of digital. I would like to say something for those who would like to ask questions now.
Per chi vorreste fare domande,
those who want to ask questions to the jury members on the stage can use a digital platform that is called Slido. Instructions are going to be shown on the screen. You can send an answer. If you're very shy, you can do it digitally, but otherwise you can raise your hand and simply ask a question.
You can ask questions by going onto the Slido platform, and we will take your questions from home. Ora avremo delle brevi.
So this said, there will be some brief interactions, visions on the future. We call them a horoscope almost, on the world of labels, of packaging, of publishing, or corporate publishing, and the various print techniques. First of all, I would like to invite to the stage Ilan Skinazzi, that is Chief Commercial Officer Paper, who's going to interview Juan Mantilla. Ilan, please come here. Thank you. Welcome here. Juan is
times, and now you're part of the jury, like some other people that we will see. But Ilan has plenty of questions for you.
Hello.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, and welcome, Juan. It's a privilege to ask a couple of questions to you. So my first question will be, first of all, to present you, Juan, you are the artistic director of a very famous makeup brand known worldwide, Kiko. And Kiko has a very core business with a target audience, very young target audience. And we know that the young generation, for them, sustainability is on their DNA. As well, we know, because we met already, that sustainability is something extremely strong for you personally. So I would like to ask, my first question is, how do you combine luxury obsession when you create packaging with sustainability? How do you do that?
Well, Ilan, there is now a trend, if you might call it trend, that companies are switching to less components or less elements in the packaging nowadays. So there is this tendency to eliminate the superfluous elements in packaging, switching from plastic to paper. And all these companies that are doing this, they are doing amazing efforts to do so. So you can see when you buy into a organic bio grocery store, they would strip down all the packaging from labels, from plastic materials, etc., and they will give you the fruit in a brown paper bag. The same exact paper, brown paper bag that will give you in the traditional market. So if you go and buy that fruit in a traditional market, probably you will get the same brown paper bag. And I think that is the real luxury, you know, the will to strip down the packaging to the minimum. It's not a minimalistic approach, no, but it's also an approach of just giving you what is necessary. If you buy an iPhone, an iPad, a MacBook Pro today, you will see that inside there is no more the thermoform inlay to hold the phone. It's paper. It's probably thermoform pulp, but it's paper. So you can throw that rigid box entirely into the waste or into the paper for recycling. So that is the real luxury, the will to create less waste. That is the luxury today.
Okay. Okay. Thank you for this first answer. My second question is, Juan, you are part of the jury. You have been a winner in the last edition. So can you tell us what is the trend of this edition? What have you seen, like, in terms of trend? Have you seen something relevant? How do you judge this edition?
Well, there was common approaches to graphic design and the use of paper. We've seen, you will see it later on the exhibition, that they are a return to basics. So limited color palettes. So there are amazing works that were submitted with only two or three inks. Very, very impactful with limited colors. Nowadays, you can do whatever you want with printing, with digital printing. You can do whatever you imagine. But this was something amazing, see people coming back to this route, to this intention. People were using letterpress, lithography, things like that you might be able to forget those techniques. And instead of that, people were returning into those techniques. So amazing use of paper, very nice die lines and die cuts, and the introduction of digital as a part of creating something similar to handcrafted. Okay. So it's let's say, if people is now returning to capture pictures in film, there is something similar happening into graphic design nowadays.
Very interesting. My last question will be around refillable packaging. Like 5 years ago, there was like a revolution in the market with refillable packaging. And we said at that time, it's going to be a revolution and it's going to change totally. And soon we will go to Sephora with our bottle to refill the fragrance, etc. Well, it has started, but it has not been like a real revolution, a big boom. How do you see refillable packaging trend with regards to sustainability, and how do you see this as a future?
Well, it's obviously key. We are not yet there. Okay. It will become massive. It will become something maybe imposed by logistics, maybe imposed by legislation. But as I was saying before, this means a lot of efforts from companies. So only big brands are able to do it right now. The refillable option is not that new. If you remember Alien and Angel from Terry Mugler.
Yeah. Absolutely, you're right.
Those were refillable in the 90s. So we are speaking about 30 years ago.
Yeah.
And they had their refill column there. So, because the bottles were so iconic and people didn't want to trash or dispose those beautiful glass bottles. They were expensive, they were heavy, and they were difficult to display. So probably they were refillable already because of that. That kind of iconicity, you don't want to throw it away, no? So, but the refillable implies also a lot of commitments, space, it implies that you can build something that will be forever. Mm-hmm. But on the contrary, you can look for alternatives by building with paper. So you switch from metal, from plastics, from aluminum to paper, and you create primary packaging in paper that is easily disposable, that you can throw it in the paper for recycling. And
you've done this. You've done with the lipsticks.
We've done it. We have done it as a brand for a lipstick. Yeah. It was wrapped in paper. The refillable is an expensive option because the consumer buy it and then they need to buy the rest. But you can do it. You could do it with a lot of products. I mean, it's just you need to challenge your ideas and your company to do it.
Thank you very much, Franz.
Speaking of challenge, we have here among the best printers and converters of Southern Europe. And I know you challenge them very often to push to the extreme, to try something that they haven't tried in a mass that you work with, because you work with huge numbers. You have print runs and box runs of, you know, hundreds of thousands when you're lucky, and sometimes it's even millions. How do you achieve such a good work together with these people to get these extraordinary results, you know?
Well, Chiara, I think the basic is the relationship. So you start with a good relationship, you trust your printer, the printer trusts you, the printer follows your crazy ideas. You study together the materials, because when we speak about paper, I mean, you need to go and test it and you need to print it. To see how it works, to see how it behaves. If we are speaking about packaging, you need to know how it folds, you need to how resistant it is, and you cannot do that alone. I mean,
so you are physically close to them.
Physically and mentally.
Yeah.
Because otherwise, it's a bad companion if you don't trust your printer, or your printer doesn't trust you, or if you don't live in the process with the printer. So. I think it's an exchange, a cultural exchange. You will become more skilled technically and also as a designer if you collaborate better with your
Absolutely.
Transformer. I mean,
partnership.
Yeah, it's a partnership relationship.
Thank Super. You. Thank you so much. We have time for one or perhaps two questions. So the floor is open for questions while we gather them. I may have an extra one.
Okay.
What about monomateriality, monomaterials in packaging? Packaging is composed of many different things. How can you really achieve?
If we come back to what we have seen now as projects and the shortlisted projects, there are a lot of monomaterial packagings. And this is important, and I forgot to mention it before, because it's not a trend. A trend is, Roger told me that a trend is an ugly word because it's what is happening now. So you are moving into a more simple packaging, not minimalistic, but a more simple constructed packaging. Mm-hmm. And you will see it from the awarded projects. This monomateriality is necessary to dispose things properly, to end up their life properly.
No?
Grazie, Juan.
Prego.
Thank you very much.
Any more questions from the audience? From home? Well, you can write. There is a special mailbox called Dear Juan. And oh no, hang on. What is your dream of packaging project to develop?
Wow, this is this is super difficult. But I think the most scalable packaging projects are food packaging, probably because of the quantities. Mm-hmm. And I think the food industry is also generating a lot of waste, from water bottles to an enormous amount of vegetables and fruits that you buy in the supermarket. So that is the dream project for me, to work in a project that you can eliminate a lot of waste and do your part.
More on this soon. Thank you so much.
Grazie a voi.
Grazie. Attenzione. Can I welcome on stage Pere Espelt, who is our super head of sales and commercial for Arconvert. Pere has a solid 30 years of experience in the label and self-adhesive industry. And the dialogue is going to be with Roger Botti, who is the managing director and creative director of Robilant. Roger, center stage.
Hi, good morning.
Do you need any water before you fall down, guys? It's very warm.
We can move like Ronaldo, if you like.
Okay, as you wish.
Okay, first of all, I would like to thank you, Roger, to give me the opportunity to share this Fedrigoni Top Awards together.
Pleasure.
And really, okay, following a little bit our friends from the paper and the packaging about the trends into the market, I would like that if you can tell us what are the trends that you see in the design of the label market also.
So first of all, what I want to underline that I was quite amazed for all the work we try to judge in the best way, but especially in the label, what I notice is that the fantasy and the freedom of all the project, I've done just a little selection here to demonstrate how there is no trend at all. Because there is a lot of a real freedom from design. And because when we talk about brand identity, packaging design, we're talking about personality. And when, and all the time we, and a lot of different occasions, we mention the personality of a brand and we compare with the personality of people. So if we think of personality, we can't talk about trends because otherwise we lose the personality. That's why I don't like the idea of following trends. All the work we judge on the label are demonstrating that there is so many possibilities, so many occasion to express ourselves as a designer, as a brand, as a product, as a production company, to do whatever we like. Probably the only trend we have to follow in the future is based on responsibility, because responsibility is a kind of new trend. We all were habit to design with not too much responsibility, following a kind of no limits idea. No, the no limits idea is not really responsible. Mm-hmm. So the new responsibility will drive new trends, but not in terms of aesthetic, in terms of content, in terms of sustainability, a kind of finding new languages.
And concerning, for example, the sustainability that you mentioned now, that could be between the breaks a trend, what are the constraints that you can see or we can detect, or the opportunities that really we can see in this trend?
I think, as I mentioned, we were happy to have no limits, like an old advertising campaign. the limit, so the constraints, will drive the new opportunity. Because we need much more clever project. And to do clever project, we need constraint. But we need to challenge constraint, understanding much more about technique, materials, printing, inks, chemical. So I think we need to study more.
That means that it's not only involved in the design, also could be involved also in the print, in our clients, in the printing companies.
Of course. So
You mentioned something about the maximum amount of coverage of a surface that is probably good to have in order for the object to be recycled, you know, smoothly.
Yeah.
Where do you learn these things? How do you study the topic?
I always say that we are very lucky because we work on a lot of different projects and we learn from our clients. We learn from the market. We learn observing. We learn from other expertise. And when we say that designer has a, so the main characteristic that the designer have to have is curiosity, because you have to be curious about the work of all the others and try to connect dots. And I think we received in the last year, not a lot of time, in the last year, I received personally 4 or 5 new, completely new brief, for example, where one of the constraints was the coverage of the ink on the material, because the recyclability, there is maximum new low are depend of the material, but are around 30% maximum of the coverage of ink. That means that for our everyday work means to design completely differently. So if you want to have a blue background like this, you probably start to think at paper colored in mass, rather than start to white paper and a lot of blue ink, and then you discover that the blue ink is probably one of the worst.
For the printers in the audience who feel like fainting, there is salt and refreshments afterwards. So there's something in the bag. Probably.
Sorry for that. Yeah, I've got. I just bring with me a quite recent project. I had the possibility
I didn't have lunch, so that's particularly interesting.
Yeah, it's not cooked, sorry. So that is a little Italian pasta maker coming from Dolomites. It's a quite a new client for us. We challenged it very much. And I was so happy about their reaction, because I went to them the first time to receive the brief, and they used to have a plastic bag, a traditional plastic bag. And because I had in mind that challenge, I arrived with a pack, the paper pack of floor, and I put on the table. That was the starting project.
Flour?
Flour, sorry.
Okay.
The pack of flour that is normally in paper. And I said, because your pasta starting from here, we can go back to here. And that's the reason why we started to work on the 100% paper with no plastic at all. So there is no double material. And we printed that with not a lot of ink, because the coverage is starting with a natural paper. And the client was very, very good and very tough to arrive to do this result on the same machinery in the factory. So that is working on the same machinery that was managing plastic without changing nothing. No other factory.
Machine. That's very good. Did they have to change the shelf life? Does this last a little bit?
No change of shelf life. Because we forgot that this is dry. Because it's dry, the shelf life is driven by the way you preserve, so it's dry. So the paper is only protecting.
Thank you, Roger. This is a brilliant example. We open the floor to questions. So do people in the audience have anything to ask or from home? Meanwhile, I have a question. How do you teach junior designers to learn about these aspects? Because this is a new toolkit that they need to have, aside from being able to push text and images on a screen.
The problem is to be, I always say, be curious about all the things. There is no one way to work. We need to be stimulated about the others and try to learn from other professionals. I think that learning, be curious about the printing, be curious about materials, be curious about what is on the back. So designer always design a lot of different things, and we are not expert of everything. We always starting from study. We always starting from study the specific commercial area. So it's always different. It's every day different.
Okay. We have a question from the audience meanwhile. If you want to have a anti-counterfeiting solution, so something that ensures that this is an original product, is it a good idea to work with complex design and premium papers and maybe
some...
I'm not
sure to understand. Are complex design...
So
premium paper, so difficult to replicate that thing.
The question is, if you have complex design and premium paper and probably some fancy printing, is this something that ensures that the product is harder to counterfeit? Maybe a very precious bottle of whiskey or gin.
Yeah. I'm always very passionate about things for a lot of people, normally. So when something is becoming very niche, very special, it's fantastic, but it's for few. It's never a big issue. So the big issue is always... So we can do a lot of different things at that level. But that's not the difficult things. The difficult things to do...
good things for the masses.
Good things for the masses.
I mean, in big numbers.
Yeah, big numbers create big issues. Small numbers can just have fun with it.
What's the most challenging element when you design a label? Is it maybe the tiny size?
Yeah, probably the size and the information, I think. More and more, depend of the category where you work on in terms of products. But people want to have more information from the product. So not just a nice label, but they want to read something. So in the last few years, I think that the most difficult thing is managing priority of readability, because information and legal information and product information, benefit, reason to believe, they are making everything potentially crowded. But that crowdness contain the reason to buy. And so we need to manage, and when the label is small, it's becoming something very, very special to manage.
Thank you so much, Roger. Thank you, Pera.
Thank you, Alain. Thank you, Roger.
They're going to be around for more questions later on. Fatevi la pasta. Can I have on stage now, I will be the Fedrigoni person making the questions and answers, and I will probably make a little bit of space because we're going to have some lovely books on this table. And can I welcome on stage Silvana Amato and Frank Gerard from Taschen. Benvenuti. Questa conversazione sarà in italiano. Frank,
this conversation is going to happen in Italian. Frank is a fake German. He speaks an excellent Italian. And he's quite often at Italian printers when he prints with Tashin. Being paper producers, we witnessed during the pandemics a change in the market, and we were wondering how the publishing market reacted. Can I help you with your face mask? Okay, we'll put it behind. How does the publishing industry react to this year and a half of pandemics? Well, I work in publishing, and at the beginning I was quite afraid. But it was a paradox because the publishing sector reacted quite well to the pandemics. Probably because books appeared for what they really are, that is to say, a necessary element in our lives. The publishing market kept producing. Yes, you're right. In fact, I'm sure you're all aware of the big turnover of publishing companies. What about your experience? Well, when Amazon said that they were only going to deliver things that were really necessary, regardless of books, so we were quite worried. However, we found out that books actually went back on track and they increased their turnover. So for our industry, the situation was less dramatic than expected. Frank, I know you have a few examples to share with us. How did you start with Tashin? And what is your experience with illustrated books? What is the situation with illustrated books? In order to tell you about that, I wanted to show you an example of Tashin. This is a book I bought in 1986 about, it is a monographic book about art. And it was an attempt to share art quite democratically because it costed 10 euros. It was a die-cutting cover, as you can see. It was quite cheap to produce. When I started to work for Tashin, the same book evolved into this format. So it was smaller, and since we were in the digital area, we were printing from digital data, having a few problems, of course, because at the beginning we were scanning a lot. However, the layout was different, and a book like that was pretty successful in museums' bookstores. In 2005, we sold 5 million copies of this book. These were 120 artists in a plethora of languages, but the market kept on changing, and we had to deal with Wikipedia, smartphones, and tablets. So whoever wanted to see something about Matisse, for example, they could go online. They didn't really need a book, so. We went for a new layout. This is the current edition. So the cover is the one that we used in 1986, but elements have changed. In fact, we are using an off-white paper that renders much better the reproduction of paints, and even the reproduction of paints is different because they have to be as close as possible to the original painting. People buying books of this sort are spoiled people. When you watch TV, the quality is really high. So if you buy a book, the quality of the images must be at the same level of the level of the images you would see on, you would watch on TV. It is also key that you use a fine paper. It is very important that it opens easily. A beautiful object, isn't it? Isn't it as democratic as it was before? How much does it cost now? It costs 12 euros, so it is still quite democratic, and it is pretty successful all over the world yet. And what I always say that if a person in Venezuela wants to buy a book about Matisse, in 80% of the cases, they would buy this very book. Thank you. What about fiction books? How is it going with their research of materials? Well, as for fiction publishing, things are quite different. In Italy, our market is still very conventional. Editions all look alike, except for independent publishings. In publishing, the white color is not widely used, and I think that this color is a strong color that should be used more, and it really recalls the use of paper. This is a project in which paper has a communication function which is pretty important. These are key projects, and the project you're seeing now is a project in which a major investment was made in paper, is slightly less successful, would have been like slightly less successful if I had taken a picture of the same book from another angle. The type of paper that was used, that we used in 2009, was the whiter one, and in fact in 2015 we could see that pages aged. I'm saying all these things because a fiction book is a book that was designed by an author making a lot of effort. So I think that authors think of people buying their books and keeping them home for a long time. That's why I think that an investment in a high quality paper should be done in order for paper not to age that bad. You're also a teacher. How do you teach young graphic designers to understand these aspects about the aging of an object, about the physical characteristics of materials? Well, one of the things I found out with my students is that there's a complete abstraction from the physical world. They design everything in front of a computer. When they say it's font 12, they don't really know what they're talking about because they see it on the screen. So when I work with them, I try to have them being as practical as possible. In the University of Urbino, we have a beautiful printing laboratory with movable characters, movable fonts. This is an important experience for all students because they, by practicing that way, they understand how you can move from a sheet of paper to a book. We carry out also some digital projects, of course. Afterwards, we verify several aspects. and inside they can post their texts. These were in English, Italian and Latin, and by doing it physically without using a computer, they understand how difficult the whole project is, and that if you make a mistake, you can't make up for it in 1 second as if you were using a computer. Let's try to watch this video. This printed material are then put together and binded. These are the students binding the book, and this is the end book. I know that you are quite obsessed with the binding of books because you say that they don't open well. Well, for example, this is a book called Dopo, After, and this was printed before. If you look at them like that, you understand which one had the highest quality paper. So I really hoped that books would open as well as this one opens. This is from a foreign publisher. And I think that all books should open as well as this one, even fiction books. Frank, you work with very famous graphic designers. Do you think they are so passionate about the materials, or do they give you a hard time? I mean, you can't be that general, because abroad there are excellent graphic designers who really care about the materials. And since, but the point is that since we're all used to the digital reality, it is then kind of difficult to get back into the actual reality. A book is made of paper. And there are things that must be understood about the material. What I've heard before is that when you work to a project, you must take into account the object and the people you're going to work with. Thank you very much. I help you with this. They're going to answer a few questions afterward, that is to say, during the cocktail.
Martina Corradi, who is the marketing manager of HP Indigo Printing, and Simon Esterson, who is the president of the jury here, but also, most importantly, the art director of I Magazine and also of Pulp Magazine. All right, I'll stay. That's fine.
And everybody's being very coy about the drink.
Yes.
I'm desperate for drink.
Still or sparkling? Here's some still.
Martina, do you want sparkling?
No, thank you. I'm okay.
Okay.
All right. So that's you.
This is the most exciting thing that you're going to see here, is me pouring and drinking
water.
Sorry,
instead of some proper drink.
No pasta.
What's happening?
No Frankfurt Book Fair.
Later.
Books and things. This is me, isn't it?
Yeah. I can do that.
No, that's right.
All right, as you wish.
Before we start, I think we should just make one little thing clear, which is that we're about to talk about digital printing. And this actually means machines that work digitally, but actually print something on a piece of paper. There have been so many sort of conversations about digital here. We're still talking about things that end up on paper, but by, you know, a technology that Gutenberg wouldn't probably recognize.
Yeah.
And I guess the first thing about this year's entries is that there are quite a lot of labels. And I wondered if you wanted to talk us through some of those entries.
Absolutely, absolutely. Welcome everybody, first of all. Nice to meet you. And yes, well, we see a lot of labels printed in digital this year. And I think this is for different reasons. First of all, because we are, well, the labels industry is an industry where you can I think showed the most, to be honest, maybe about digital, and you can play a lot around it. And also because we have a movement, we say before, they say, my co-worker in the jury, that we don't speak about trends, because trends is something actually that is actual, but there is a movement at the moment of, let's say, playing a lot in the label industry, and we play it in different way. For example, we have the Dual Witch gene that we can see on the screen behind me. That is a good example of this, where we can see something that you can do just with digital, which is variable data.
So every bottle is unique?
Exactly. Every bottle is unique. Every bottle is different. This is made with a process that the name is Mosaic, where basically you define some part on the paper, and you are going to change the color that you have in the different papers.
So here we're seeing images and colors changing.
Exactly. And so you are creating a unique object. So your brand will be identified on the market because it's the same, but what you are going to see different is that you're going to have a unique product. So
this is
edition.
A way for a brand to convince the distribution point to buy lots
exactly,
of those.
Exactly, and share it on social media, so give a brand identity and moving in this direction. Another example of this is another gene that is the Last Colony gene. This is another example, in this case, of versioning, because I really like this project because it's a work between different kind of papers as well, and I think it can, it show a lot of versioning as well. So we see this one of the gene, for example, but there is a category of all of them. So what I can see, I can identify my product on the market, even if they are different products. One close to the other, as we can see here.
Yeah, so here we've got the gin and various
exactly.
wine.
Exactly. So this is something that we can notice in this project as well.
And I suppose the other thing about some of this year's entries is that initially digital printing had rather a bad reputation for the way it would print on paper, and you know, the impression was that actually you could just print on white paper. But we've actually got a couple of entries that are really strong on using color on colored paper.
Yes, that's correct. There are two samples that I would like to mention today. One is this one that is Object and Subject, which is a product that speaks about, I guess, the power of the woman that we can see in terms of color, but also the kind of paper that got used. Because if we can see here a very strong very strong colors used. We can also see that the paper, if you touch it, as I did, is very light papers. So it's a contradiction as well in what a woman is eating at the end of the day as well.
And these colors are not special colors. These are just
CMYK colors. Correct. And another example that can show this, let's say, synchronization between colors and the paper is this project about moon, where we can see that is printed actually on is white premium white inks by HP Indigo that is printed on black material. So here there is just the color, basically. Yeah.
So in a way, it's a complete inversion of the way you might handle the job in LIFO, which is you take black paper and you print with white inks.
Exactly.
And you can lay the white inks down multiple times to increase their weight.
Yes, exactly. And also it's very nice, they had die cut that it was done.
As you open the book, the phases of the moon are revealed to you. I mean, it's a remarkable piece of visual design.
Exactly.
So we just saw a little hint. This is this is a Brazilian magazine called Tipografia, which is about the history of type and graphic design. But one of the fascinating things about it is that it's a mixture of letterpress printing, so the most old-fashioned printing technology, and
digital
color sections printed on the on the Indigo Press.
Yes, and this is what is make this project unique, I think, because it can show you, because a lot of people think that digital is just something that it cannot be, you know, compare, or it cannot be used with, let's say, old technology or more old technology than digital. But this is not true, because this is a good example of how I can mix letterpress, which is one of the oldest kind of technology that you can use for printing, with digital, which is one of the newest one, and you can create a unique product that is completely working good together.
It's an amazing, amazing thing. In fact, Juan and I had to get his loop out earlier to work out which were the letterpress pages and which were the you know the digital pages. I think this is from the next.
This is from the
thing.
Next one. Yeah. Yeah. Sorry.
So no. It's just a hint. It's a hint of what's to come. We've been talking about training and how graphic designers and young graphic designers get to know about sustainability and other issues, but I guess the thing with the digital printing machines is that it's quite difficult now to pop down to your local printers. Even if it wasn't for the pandemic, printers tend to be out of town and they're not quite as welcoming. But understanding how these machines work and what their capabilities and their strengths are, and why they're different from conventional printing is pretty important. So how do you do that? How do you train the next generation of graphic designers?
This is a very good question, because it's a very big challenge also for us. I mean, we are asking ourselves this question a lot of time, to be honest. And I think you have to be a work together. So every part of the supply chain should work in this direction, to be honest, as provider of the technology, but also our customer that they're using this technology, they have to give the possibility to the graphic designer to see what they can be done with this kind of technology to making this more unknown and aware about the possibility of digital.
Yeah, because we can look at these examples, but in fact, a lot of the story about digital is the story of the workflow and the story that
exactly.
You can make one copy
exactly
in a way that is impossible in other methods or incredibly expensive.
But this means that you need to have the whole value chain downstream adjusting to digital printing. Whoops.
Yes, I mean, I think if you take something like on-demand book printing,
yeah,
actually, in a way, printing one copy of the book is the easy bit. Finding one copy perfectly, getting it in the right envelope, going to the right person, and having that account automatically fulfilled, that's the bit that all the concentration's on now, isn't it?
Correct. A workflow process, as we just said. You have to start from the order as well. If we're speaking about the Book of One, for example, I don't know, from the book on delivery or whatever product on delivery, to be honest, because at the moment also in the packaging industry, they're moving in that direction. So starting from that point, you have to have a supply chain that is working in that direction. So from the order online until the delivery to the customer side.
And in a way, sustainability is built into that process, because people can ask the question, what really, how many copies do I need? Not, oh, let's have 5,000 copies for the warehouse, but this is the specific number. And if we run out, well, we can just print some more.
That's correct.
And if you have something that you have chosen, maybe with your name on top,
yes.
I don't think you're going to throw it away that easily.
Exactly.
Maybe it's going to last a bit
exactly.
longer
exactly.
in your home or on your desk.
Yeah, so I think there's a whole set of new digital possibilities, including the inks, including the run length, including the kind of materials you can print on.
Yes.
Thank you very much. If there are questions from the audience, we'd like to take them. Oh, here's one.
Yes, sir. The printing will change.
Do you think digital printing will change the way that to design projects, as it gives some new possibilities?
Can I answer?
Yeah.
I think
this is your go.
I think yes. I mean, I think he has already changed if we see already some campaign that they're resisting. So we're moving in the short run direction, but we're also moving in a lot of limited edition. Like, I don't know, to mention just the Nutella campaign with the name on top of those kind of campaigns. I think that the design is moving in a direction where people want a unique product and they want a product that is just for themselves. So I think that the change is already happening. It's not something that is going to happen in the future. Maybe a lot more, but it's already there.
And I think all the kind of web-to-print workflows that go with these machines are completely changing the kind of graphic design that is done. It's hugely expanding the area of people who call themselves, you know, graphic designers, because I call myself a graphic designer, but people don't need me anymore. They've got a Mac, they've got the web address for a web-to-print company. They can shoot it off all by themselves.
Without ever interacting with the printer?
Well, the interaction is an online interaction. And I think, you know, one of the things about having a huge installed base of similar machines is we're seeing people saying, well, we can print this book in Italy for one copy, and we can print this book in Shanghai for one copy, and we're using the same printing machine and the same paper.
And the same mix.
Yeah, so the books will be the same. And that means you don't have to ship that copy to Shanghai, you don't have to ship that copy from China to Milan. Yes. I think we're only really beginning to understand the possibilities that go with the digital machines.
Wow. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
This is really exciting.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you, Martina. Simon, you're actually going to stay.
I'm going to stay, yeah.
Yeah. Simon, we have this category, which is corporate identity. And we use this name for anything that you don't pay for, basically. So from a business card to a poster of, you know, a concert or a financial report or a brochure. So is things that help you imagine something or help you remember something, but you know, it's not around a product. I mean, it is, but you know, it's free. It's freebies. And these are the artifacts that we've seen less of, perhaps, in this pandemic year, because people have had the habit of just, you know, choosing something online and, you know, losing your sight on, you know, big sets of data.
Yeah, I mean, maybe they have gone into hiding slightly, but I think this is an amazing category because I think there's a lot more scope.
Yeah.
Are we waiting for the slides?
Yeah, well, they are there, but they're not on the tiny screen.
Okay. There's a lot more scope, I think, in this category. So why don't we just look at a few? So this is a set of season brochures for a theatre company. And what we see is a black cover, beautifully printed with silver ink, and then each season has a different coloured paper inside, like these. And the black cover is quite heavy, the inside pages are thin, too thin. And in fact, I know we're not allowed to use the word trend here today, but there's a definite trend towards printing on ultra thin paper, almost, you know, show through. The idea of seeing what's happening on the reverse was a terrible thing. Now it's completely acceptable.
After so many years of printers giving us hard times because you had some see-through, now everyone wants see-through.
I think
see-through.
You have to embrace the see-through, don't you?
Yeah.
And what's great about these theatre brochures is, you know, it is a coloured paper and it is black ink and one other colour, and they are dramatic and they are bold. And I don't know if we've got we haven't got the third one. We'll go back. There's a season that's missing. You probably saw it right at the beginning. April to June, cancelled. And they've embraced that too.
Oh,
so,
wow.
So actually, you can see the cancel line through the type. And then inside, the pages are blank because there was no theatre during that point in the pandemic.
That's very beautiful. And dramatic.
It's a theatrical response, I think, to the situation. And we'll see other things too, like this next job, which are about resources. And I think, you know, there was a time when colour printing was special. And I think we have to acknowledge now that colour printing is not special anymore. So we see lots of people not using full colour printing. You know, it's been talked about earlier, a lot of these corporate jobs. Now, this is another example, which is the kind of flexible corporate identity. So again, this is a company called Sculpt, and what we see is this letter S, which morphs and transforms from business card to business card. And you know, there was a time when everybody expected their business card to be exactly the same and to be white, but here they're different. The different sizes, they're different orientations, and they're different. Paper? They're different paper colours. Of course, sorry, I was going to mention paper. They're different paper colours. All good, all very good Fedrigoni paper colours, and they're printed in a mixture of black and white. And then here we see that this is a Sculpt brochure, and again we see this S morphing on the different brochure fronts. And you know, this job is. We talk about, you know, creativity and things. This job exemplifies the thing that I would, the little secret that we haven't mentioned a lot today, which is graphic design. This is actually a really smart piece of graphic design. You know, one could imagine this just being, you know, a cover and a title on the front, but instead this morphing S responding to the content. I mean this is what a graphic designer.
And also, this gives you the idea of a real company.
Yes.
With all gravitas somehow.
All these things are about making things a bit more real on a flat screen. I think we've all discovered during the pandemic what we can do online, and we've probably all discovered the sort of limit of what you can do online. Everything is a little bit. We've got moving image. It's colourful. You can buy moving image stock photography in the same way you can buy conventional stock photography. It's very easy to put something together online that makes it look like, you know, your one-person bakery business is in fact the biggest, you know, baker in Europe. And it's a bit flat, and strangely, it's a bit like another business. And I completely believe in physical things and in paper and in graphic design defining jobs. This is a fantastic little job. This is license information, a mattress reseller. It's printed in black. What actually, it's digital as well, on another kind of digital press. What's amazing about the job is the paper color. They are metallic Fedrigoni papers, and the metallic paper, and the combinations when you simply have one page facing another.
It's always a nightmare. I'm always amazed at how
the paper,
printers and binders can.
They're just folded and stapled pages, and the paper makes the job. I mean, plus, you know, the bold graphics, but essentially what's making this job is the gold paper butting up against silver paper, I think. You know, this is another kind of thing you can't do on screen, which is about textures. So here for Cavalleria Delgado, we've got a symbol that's a mixture of sort of free-form blind embossing, and there's a very crisp gold outline square, gold outline, white centre on the front. And I think it just reminds you that, you know, you don't have to use type, you can use pattern, and you can just simply use foiling and blind embossing to make something, to make something
memorable.
Physical. Memorable, yes.
Yep.
This is another use of technology. So this is a calendar, and a calendar printed with elements of ultraviolet ink. So that when you expose it to ultraviolet light, it looks like this. You know, that's a whole other world that's developing, is the, you know, the world that's beyond CMYK. You know, it's being able to lay down, obviously, metallic inks, fluorescent inks, and coatings too. The whole world of sort of gloss coatings and matte coatings, and the combination of the two. This job for Golden Moments, it's large format, and it's literally folded pages. It's not even stapled. And it's a series, a whole series of different posters. And so what's wonderful about it, if I can make it change, is that all these posters are folded together. So when you flip through it in its folded form, you have this amazing combination of completely different projects facing each other. So you get metallic, lush photos facing black and white type. It's a really incredibly simple idea, a bit like that license brochure. Just the power of folding paper and the way you assemble it. And then just in case everybody thinks that I'm completely against using resources, you know, occasionally, so this is a brochure for Kempinski hotels, and you know, they've used all the tools that are available. It's a case-bound book. It's got a
blind
embossed, and a really nice bit of blind embossing. You're not hanging around there, really
hard
stamping it in. It has different page widths and different paper textures. So you have, you know, the rich four-color pictures on coated stock, and then you have transparent pages for maps and interleaving. And so, you know, this is a book that makes a narrative by its use of materials. And I mean, you know, I think that's the exciting thing, isn't it? We can have this, which is, you know, clearly a four-color job with a big budget.
It's a big statement to be in every Kempinski room.
Exactly.
This is it.
Exactly.
Do you think that the hospitality and the tourism hotel sector, you know, we've seen some changes, you know, menus have in some instances disappeared, in some others they are in, you know, terrible plastic cases and so on. Brochures are mainly online. And then there is plethoras of single-use plastic. Maybe I think we had
Is this time for your shaming picture?
Yeah, the shaming picture. You know, many of us are hosted at the lovely Una Hotel nearby, and there is a shower of single-use plastic, and sometimes there is plastic within plastic, because you open these pockets and you find that the final thing that you need is wrapped into another thing.
Well, I mean, the irony here is, I think, is the plastic cup wrapped up in the plastic bag.
Yes,
which but I sort of, you know, I understand all the reasons.
But there is more irony in a little note that says that, you know, you're going to help the Earth, the planet, I mean, survive more if you don't use your towels.
I mean, we're both in danger of not being let into our rooms later on.
You know, I
that,
think so.
That little plastic key that I've got will be turned off.
That would be demagnetized.
But it's slightly sad that a really, you know, very nicely designed and built hotel actually. Pretty much for me, everything about what you see here is it's not as good as the hotel. You know,
it's all in the name of brand identity, because clearly all these pieces come from different Asian manufacturers, and then you need to wrap them up to make them look like a brand. But
yes, kind of, and they don't look like a brand, but also they don't have the mindset of a brand that's trying to say, you know, we understand the pandemic, but there are things you can do with paper and with other materials that are more sophisticated than a Ziploc plastic bag.
Totally. Couldn't agree more. Is there any questions to this section on brochures, financial reports? Oh, yes. Do you think the use of corporate identity materials should increase now that we are all turning digital, or is it not so interesting anymore? Well, we kind of answered to that probably, but if there is any,
I think it's just changing, isn't it? So there'll be some kinds of corporate identity material that you no longer print, but there'll be other things, perhaps things we don't already have, that you will produce, I think. And I think people will get very bored with, I'm already bored with kind of, you know, fintech companies, and for me, all of our identities are all the same, and they're all online, and they're indistinguishable to me. So at some point, somebody will come along and go, well, actually, we're gonna do this printing.
When you have to choose something really expensive, or something that will last for quite some time, for example, Michaela has recently been redoing her home, and there were catalogs and things. So when you choose something like, you know, you've got a have a new wooden floor or things like that. Do you think that that's the kind of choice that people need a catalog for to, you know, to ask their family about that? Or
if I was going to buy a wooden floor, I'd go to a showroom.
Yeah, because you would need to see the real thing.
I don't, you know, it's better in a printed brochure than it is online, but neither actually compete with actually
the
physically. Yeah, I mean, I think in a way, online is fantastic sometimes for clearly predictable things and repeat things. But I love shops. I'm waiting to get into that shop out there and spend far too much money on a lot of good design books.
But the good thing is that everything that we've seen here flipping through the screen is actually physically out there at the exhibition. So, you know, thank you very much. I think now it's time that we, you know,
I disagree.
Clear the mystery. No. Well, you know, you're going to reappear when we're going to award the, when you're going to call the winners of the corporate identity category. So one little note before we proceed. So now we're going to have the four categories being awarded. We will ask the people to come on stage. Probably we don't need the chairs anymore. So I would like to start calling Juan to solve this mystery of what has the jury decided. And by the way, if it wasn't clear, you know, Fedrigoni is not part of the jury, so our pet projects, you know, we could not influence the jury in any way. There's been some discussions about it. So I don't think I need this anymore. That's wonderful to know. Probably water we still need. No, we don't. Okay, take it away. Fine, yep. So Juan, do we want to start from
The third
position?
Yes, Chiara. Unfortunately, no one from the third and the second places are here due to the COVID restrictions on travel. So
we can announce them.
Yes. On the third place, we have Jordi's Chocolate. The designer and the brown order owner is Jordi's, and the printer is Ducase, which I don't know. I hope to meet them. And they're going to receive the prize at home or not? Yes. Okay. So, the second place is Bazao Gongfu Tea Bag Collection. They made a fantastic project on a tea collection of archive and tea bags. You will see it later on the exhibition. The designer is Shame on You, and the office from Shanghai, I think so. The brown owner is Bazao Tea, and the printer is Fankun Changping Packaging. So, difficult to say. This is what I was talking about, okay?
They've been printed on Savile Row, Tintoretto, so lots of beautiful papers, and you know, there's lots of variety, and you will
very
see
well
that when you see them.
Also.
What about the first prize?
Yes, Martina's giving that award, I think so.
Should I present it?
Please.
Okay. So the first prize this year is both the first prize of Fedrigoni Top Awards for packaging, but also the Indigo Prize for the packaging segment. And one second, that I don't have my glasses. So the designer is, well, the prize is winner by Armatore, Lo Zingaro di Mare.
Bravi.
Bravissimi.
Dove sono loro?
The designer. The designer is Lettera 7, the brand owner is Armatore, and the printing company are Graphic & Appa and MV Packaging.
Can you come on stage, please?
Sono lì loro.
The Dare, very well done. You're fantastic.
Uno, due.
Perfect.
Prego.
Please come here.
Bravi ragazzi, bravi.
Very well done, very well done. A beautiful project. You're fantastic. You can take off your mask for the photograph if you wish. Very well done. And also, I would like to congratulate with Fedrigoni Naples team that assisted them in this project. Very well done, Luciano.
Hands, but it's as if we've shaken hands. Oh, you will wonder about what are the stickers that you have received. So designers have a purple sticker, printers have a green sticker, and brands have a salmon kind of color sticker. So afterwards, if you want to interact with people and exchange views, you can choose the right ones. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
For label, we should have Roger nearby, but since Roger has probably disappeared for a second, why don't we award the publishing category? So I would ask Frank and Silvana to come on stage. And I will go closer to the other side. So we have four winners here, or maybe even, yeah, we've got, well, should we start from the third place?
Yes, let's start from the third place. It is given to Phoenix Art from artist Xiong Song. The designer is Lin Lei Studio, brand owner Shanghai People's Fine Arts Publishing House, and the printer is Shanghai Artron Art Printing.
And the papers are Arena, Materica, and Stucco Old Mill from the Fedrigoni Paper China team.
And also printed on tatami, the inside.
Is it?
Yes.
I don't see that here.
Beautifully printed.
We'll see that later. Thank you.
So the second place in publishing goes to the publication Molly Notch and the New Typography, designer by Julia Neller Design, brand owner Institute Design Lab Gutenberg, and the printer is Druckerei Kettler.
On tatami.
On tatami, yes.
Welcome.
And they are here. Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
Thank you very much. Vielen Dank. Grazie.
Gratulation.
Bellissimo. Yeah.
Good.
Thank you.
And
the first place.
And the first place with my English.
Ma puoi dirlo in italiano?
No.
No.
Ma the first place is for No One Can Fail or Écrire Son Nom. Designer studio Jean del Bello, brand owner non standard, the printer Svan Lenoir, maybe.
And it's printed on Arco Print Milk, Splendor Gel, and Symbol Free Life Raster. So the brand owner is non standard. Merci. Grazie molte. And this is a very special book because it's about the work of Marion Bataille. And, she's a bit of an icon for a lot of designers. And, you know, we all have the Marion Bataille books. And we didn't know about her work with schools.
E me fa anche...
Yes.
E a me fa piacere anche tutte queste donne sul palco dell'editoria.
Sì, all these publishing women on stage. Then there's the HP Indigo Prize. Who is going to present it? Maybe Martina can do it. Come here, Martina.
Specialised of HP Indigo for the publishing segment, which is Tipografia magazine, issue 12. The designer is Tupigrafia, the brand owner is Officina Tipografia San Paolo, and the printer is Officina Tipografia San Paolo and Innovate Graphic Digital. I don't think they're here today.
Someone is, yeah.
Someone is?
Someone over.
Ah, from San Paolo.
Allora, tu dagli questo, e io gli do questo, e tu prendi questo, grazie.
To give them this, and I will give them this. Welcome here from Sao Paulo, from Brazil. Welcome here. There are two of them. Here it is. Thank you. Thank you.
Esso, Century Cotton Wove, Old Mill. You've used a lot of paper. Lovely. Thank you so much. Bravissimi, grazie.
Very well done, thank you.
Ma lei nel mio elenco.
The special mention is a beautiful book called L'architecture des arbres. The designer is Bunker, and the owner is the Fondation Cartier pour l'Art Contemporain. It's printed by ABS, Editoriale Bortolazzi, that we know very well. So we would like to welcome on stage the representative of Fondation Cartier, and also Bunker. Eccone uno. Vado, vado su, vado su, vado su. E voilà.
Congratulations.
Divertente.
Congratulations.
This is a beautiful project, so really thank you very much for bringing that to life again.
Yes.
I saw the work of Cesare Leonardi and Franca Staggi at the London Design Biennale 3 or 4 years ago now, and to see the book again is just beautiful. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Good.
And this is one of the complicated projects that happened between Italy and France. So France follows one side and then Italy supplies the paper and it's printed here. So you can see that, you know, design, printing, paper and brands, you know, they work all over the place. And so it's important that we have this common language. Shall we go on with the label category? Roger, can I ask you to present the winners of the label category? Starting from number 3. Puoi togliere la maschera? No, non si sente. Microfono.
Grand Bouquet. And Grand Bouquet.
Studio. Brand owner Bodegas de Occidente. Printer Etie.
So we welcome on stage Eva Arias. Thank you so much. You. We saw that you have come with a very young designer. Fantastico. Eva, thank you so much. And thank you for choosing us. And thank you to the Spanish team.
Brand owner, brand breeder, printer, Eurostampa and Tonuti Tecniche Grafiche.
Okay. Ah, sì? Pera! Where is Pera? Oh. Ah, anyway. Because otherwise I would... Fernando, can you help me giving these awards? Because they are many. It's been printed on cotone bianco, cotone nero, and then polypropylene clear gloss. So Fernando Giron from our convert is here, Fedrigoni self-adhesive, to give the award to some of you, because there are 3 awards. Uno, due, e tre.
1, 2, and 3.
Grazie mille.
Thank you very much.
Stay here, in case we have...
And the winner is La Lepre e la Luna, designer numero 4, brand owner La Lepre e la Luna, printer L Commercial.
Stiamo stai. Due e tre. Io. Ma per la foto.
You can stay here for the photograph. Thank you very much. La Lepre e la Luna, you're so numerous. Thank you very much.
Then we have the AKP special selection.
Oh, AKP special selection. You go.
Bye, prego. I will give the prize.
So, Quinta Dos Montes, designer Nauvegar, brand owner Isaac Lages Paiva, printer Vox, Organizacao Industrial Grafica.
No, questo solo. Grazie. Congratulations. Congratulations.
And then this is the second. Birrificio sul mare. Designer Dario Frattaruolo Design, brand owner Birrificio sul mare. Printer Rotocell Space.
Sì. Complimenti.
Grazie, grazie.
Complimenti.
Grazie.
Aspetta. Complimenti. Posto.
Ma tu non vai su?
Vado su anch'io.
Dai, dai, sono
vengo, la faccio con voi. Sì, dai.
I seminari con visto.
Ah.
Designer Spazio Di Paolo, brand owner, brand breeder, printer, modulo C, modulo C.
Spazio Di Paolo, io non penso. Com'è possibile? Spazio Di Paolo vince
Spazio
sempre. Fantastico.
Non c'è, mi sa, il passo. Non sono arrivati.
Non lo so. Dov'è?
Complimenti. Grazie.
Grazie mille, Roger. And then corporate publishing. Simon, will you help me? You've got the mic? Okay. Oh, perfect. So we'll give this back. Thank you very much. Shall we start from the third?
Number three, yes. So the third place corporate identity winner is Golden Moments. Can we get a picture?
Picture? Golden Moments?
It's a quiet golden moment, I think, is the answer. Nice type.
Nice type, yeah.
Nice type. Better printed, but not a bit big like this.
Golden Moments? So I'll be here, probably.
Okay, so... Golden Moments. So this is, we actually saw it earlier. This is it's outside, you can see it. It's this amazing folded together book. So the winner is, the client is Golden UK, the designer is Golden UK, and the printer is Precision. Do you want to
read
the paper?
And it's made on Sirio Pearl, symbol free like glass, woodstock, and Arco print. So well done to the Fedrigoni Paper UK team.
And the second place goes to the E. Cuccini book. So this is an example of, actually, if you're going to print a very sophisticated brochure, this is what you do. The designer is Katia Massaro. The brand owner is Key. This is the other job.
The wrong images.
Wait, it's more good. It's good to see more of Golden Moments again.
Golden Moments doesn't want to go away.
And the printer for Key Cuccini is Cortella Poligrafica.
Oh, here there we go. Key Cuccini.
So it's a, again, it's on display outside. You can see it's two really beautifully produced books in a mega and a micro, and they fit together.
And it's printed on ultra black, Sirio Pietra, gray, and Xper premium white from the Fedrigoni Verona branch. Come on over. Health and safety here, we gotta be careful. Uno, due, e tre.
Congratulations.
Bravissimi. Uno per Katia Massaro. Bravi.
Okay, and now we go on to the winner in this category, which is a project called Big Kitchen. And it's a brilliant example of taking a brief and turning it into something much wider. So it's actually about a typeface, but you get an event, they've sort of constructed a narrative around the typeface, and you get even get a little stencil version of the typeface that you can use yourself. It's a brilliant piece of kind of thought through and exciting design. So the client is De Sisto in Portugal, as is the designer, as is the printer. Have we got the team here to...
Art and Materica. Thank you to De Sisto also for coming all the way to here. De Sisto.
Congratulations.
Well done. Ben fatto. Bravi, ragazzi. And thank you to the Lisboa Fedrigoni team. Thank you so much. Thank you, Simon. We have a special award, which is the popular vote, let's say. So people could vote online for the preferred project. And the winner is It Showcase. And the designer is IM Comunicazione. So welcome on stage. So the client is Teorema Mediterraneo, and has been printed at Naturalmente Stampa in Italy on Arena White. Thank you very much. Un progetto bellissimo. Grazie. It's time for us to think about refreshments and looking at all these beautiful things live. A couple of notes are that all the winners can get their copy of the catalog right outside, and there is a box for you. And at 5 o'clock and at 6 o'clock, there's going to be guided tours to the Design Museum available, so you can you know, join the tours that starts at 5 and at 6. And otherwise, now it's really time to enjoy the live interaction between us. So find your favorite designer, find your favorite printer, talk to us, talk to each other, look at the objects, touch them, enjoy them. And the beautiful thing is that we'll all see each other in Paris next year in November. So the screen should say Paris 2022 now. But so thank you again, and have fun. Music on and people can stand up.
Having said a thing or two about the vision.